feeling empty like you knew I would. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should. But Lord, I hope this day is good. Lord, have you forgotten me? I've been praying to you faithfully. I'm not saying I've done all I can, but Lord, I know you'll understand. I don't need fortune and I don't need fame. Send down the thunder, Lord, send down the rain. But when you're planning just how it will be, plan a good day for me. Lord, I hope this day is good. I'm feeling empty like you knew I would. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should. But Lord, I hope this day is good.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the virtual church, originating here in the state of Washington on this beautiful but cold December day. This day that one of our great leaders of the past, Franklin Roosevelt, said would live on in infamy, because it was December 7th that the Japanese did the sneak attack on Pearl Harbor and killed hundreds and hundreds of our American servicemen, and World War II was officially launched for America. Well, that's a long time ago, and now Japan is our ally, and there's a new enemy over in the Far East, maybe not so new, but that the Japanese and the Americans both have to contend with, and that's the mighty Colossus of China. And we won't get into that right now, but I'd like to devote a program to China and prophecy sometime soon. Well, I hope it's a good day where you are. I know it's terribly cold in many parts of America. We heard from our daughter in Spokane. She said it was down to 4 degrees. Well, when it gets down that low, everything sort of creaks, and it's just cold and drafty and kind of miserable, hard to stay warm. And I can remember our days back in rural Maryland, upstate Maryland near the Pennsylvania line, when we had some terrible cold spells back in the 70s, big snows and deep freezes getting down to 20 below zero. And it was just hard to be outside in weather like that, hard to keep anything running as well. But fortunately, it's not that cold where we are here, and I hope you're making do where you are. I might be praying for your fellow brothers and sisters that God will watch over them in this coldness and keep them warm. Well, before we begin our service today, would you join me as we ask God's blessing? Father Yahweh, great God of light, bless us now with your truth. Bless us with your loving spirit and your grace. May it warm our hearts to know that you have for us an everlasting kingdom, rewards in heaven reserved for us, to be brought to this earth and given to us as part of the bounty that you're going to share with us everlastingly. Father, we have that hope, we have that faith, and we know that you, as the God of all creation, can do whatever you want. You're the sovereign, all-powerful, mighty Lord Sabaoth of armies of impenetrable power. So, Father, we trust you to bring about what you promised you always have. And it's in that trust now that we gather on the Sabbath to learn more of you, of your plan, to study your word, to learn from Christians of times past what they experienced. For we're all the same. Our emotions, our journeys in life may vary in specific circumstances, but that we're the same flesh and blood human beings with the same temptations and the same struggles. Help us, Father, to learn from one another, strengthen one another. Bless us now as we study your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, our first little message today is entitled A Perfect Presentation. I've always wanted to have one of those. I don't think I've ever had one, but you know, where everything just goes right. Well, I'm not talking about that kind of presentation. They're pretty few and far between. But a perfect presentation that God's going to make. And you know who he's going to be presenting? He's going to be presenting you and me, I hope. And we're going to be perfect. Really? Perfect? Well, that's what it says. What do you mean? It says. Well, that's what Jude says in his letter. And let's read it. It's part of his doxology. Doxos, the Latin Greek derivative for simply, well, it's kind of hard to translate, actually. It's grace and glory and radiance and all that kind of put together. But it's at the close of this tiny, short, little jam-packed letter, which we are not going to read the whole thing, but we're just going to read the doxology of it. But first, let's open with verse 1 of Jude 1. Remember, Jude was the brother of Jesus, brother of James, and rose to some prominence in the New Testament and wrote this letter. It's a very hard-hitting letter, and he's attacking Gnosticism, which is having its beginning at this time, and false teachers and all sorts of troubles in the church. And he has two guns on him. He shoots from both hips. Powerful speaker, powerful writer. And he names names, calls names, and just is a firebrand, really, when you read this book of James. One metaphor after another. One example after another. Of bad people, and people have gone wrong, and where they've gone wrong, all for the purpose of warning us to, you know, avoid all that stuff. Well, it begins in verse 1 of Jude. It's right before the book of Revelation. It's only one chapter. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ, a brother of James. So he wouldn't bring up James unless James was well known to the audience. Of course, James was. James was the brother of Jesus, the head of the Jerusalem church, and probably in time the lead apostle in Judea. Where Peter went and the others, we don't know for sure after a period of time, after scattering. We know Paul went to the Gentiles. And Peter spent some time among the circumcision as well, and may have been in Rome too. To those who have been called, and often the word called here, the called, is just a euphemism for the church, another name for those of the church, Christians, in other words, who are loved by God the Father. I like the way he puts this together. Isn't that what you want from a father, a love? Well, it's what you get from God the Father. Who are loved by God the Father, and kept by Jesus Christ. Well, what's the job of Jesus? Well, he's to keep us. And this is kind of what an elder brother would do for his siblings, his fellow brothers, right? His fellow sisters in the family. He would keep them, watch over them, keep them safe. Well, he's doing this in a much broader way now as the head of the call, the head of the church. But Jude's got it right. And Jude calls himself a servant. There, the Greek word is doulos, which means slave, you know, a bond slave, just a total one who is committed to God, and to his elder brother, Jesus Christ. He's their servant. He's given his life to their service. And that's what he's doing. Then he gives us greeting, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. So everything's uplifting here at this point. Very gracious, very kind, very high, inspiring. And coming from this gentleman, and he knew to whom he was writing, it was a welcome letter. Now, the warnings that come, of course, are very strong. And a lot of examples, and we won't get into those right here, but he does it all with a good purpose. And a good purpose is for us to avoid that path. And people were creeping into the church at that time, leading people astray, and it really bothered him. Bothered him terribly. And he was, you might say, militant against that. That's why this strong attack, and it is an attack, on those that would come in and lead people astray from the faith, because he knew that God the Father loved him, and he knew his brother, and his brother was trying to keep and care for him and bring him eventually to the everlasting kingdom. And then to have these other creeps come in with their sexual immorality and their phony grace and all the things he describes in this chapter is thoroughly disgusting to him. And his examples are poignant. And sometime we'll go through them. But now he's through with that. He says, avoid all that, and you know, don't even get so close that your clothes smell of the fire. I mean, really, really avoid it. And you'll avoid a lot of trouble, a lot of disaster. Don't play games with these people, because their ends are evil. And there is evil in this world, isn't there? You know, is everybody good? Is everybody right? Does everybody want to go in the right direction? Out for everybody else's welfare? Or are there some people out for one another's destruction? Just been reading articles here about the Central African Republic, misnomer, of course. But it's in utter chaos right now in Africa, in civil war, with machetes flying, gunshots and the rest, where these Muslim marauders are coming down and slaughtering Christians, men, women, and children, raping the women, cutting limbs off, cutting heads off, slaughtering by the hundreds. And the Christians are fleeing. And they're fleeing to the airports or wherever they can be. And the French are flying in. There used to be a French colony there. And so they've flown in about 1,500 French troops on helicopters and the rest to try to protect those that are being assaulted and slaughtered. Well, who would want to do such things? So picture of one man there and with his wife trying to escape and six children. And are there some evil people trying to kill somebody else they don't even know? Well, yes, we know that. Are there evil philosophies? Yes. Well, didn't Lenin think that it was okay to kill some bodies and crack some eggs in order to make the omelet of socialism and communism? Remember what he did in Ukraine, which was the breadbasket for Russia? In order to get the peasants off their farms, he starved them. And he killed about 8 to 10 million of them in order to take their land from them and put their land into these big communes, and so they could do it by the book, by central planning. You know, kind of like our healthcare thing here. It's all going to be done by the government. And they're so efficient, as we know. Well, of course, food production went down the toilet. Famine was everywhere. But the people were also dead. Now, who is willing to do this to these helpless people who own this land? Well, people had evil philosophies. Do we have this sort of thing in religion, too? people coming in talking big, as Jude mentions here, boisterous and loud, making their claims and everything else for their own selfish aims. Well, sure, we need to be on guard against that, not to be paranoid, but to be aware of it. It exists. So he says, hey, don't even get close to it. Stick to the beautiful, clean truth that's been presented to you. Now he's saying goodbye in this doxology here. In verse 23, we begin reading it. And it's been used often in Christianity, versions of this doxology over the years. And you can see why. It's beautifully done. And as I mentioned, the word doxos here means glory, or a word with connotations kind of difficult to capture exactly, but having to do with moral splendor or radiance. This is how he closes. To him who is able to keep you from falling. Now, who's that? Well, that's God the Father he's talking about here. To him who is able. Now, not everybody's able, but somebody is able to keep you from falling. In other words, you will not fall if you stay with him. Who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence. He's going to present you to himself before his presence. In other words, bring you into the heavenly entourage, as it were, of the glory of God, to receive your crown and your reward, and descend with the Father and the Son to set up the kingdom on earth, is the picture behind this. Present you with his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. Without fault. Or some translations say, present you perfect. Well, the same thing, without fault. In fact, the exact same word is used speaking of Jesus, who was a lamb perfect or faultless in 1 Peter 1:19 as the sacrificial lamb, perfect, faultless. Same word is used of us, presented before God, perfect and faultless. Now, how does that happen? Now, most of us don't go around saying, I'm perfect, I'm faultless, I'm just never made a mistake. Well, no, this is not what it's speaking about here. As I've mentioned many times, biblical perfection in the eyes of God as he looks at his children is quite different than what we see it. Perfection has to do with the direction your life is moving. If you're moving toward God, Godward, trying to please him, he forgives sins. He forgives those faults. He looks not upon them. As far as he's concerned, you are perfect, because for a human being there can be nothing more perfect than to be moving Godward, striving to please your heavenly Father and follow the example of his Son. Now, that is Christian perfection. It is not the absence of any little fault or blemish or sin or something of that physical nature. Well, he's going to present you to his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. So it's going to be a happy time, a wonderful happy time. To the only God. So, was Judah a monotheist? Well, of course he was. He didn't believe in two gods. Believed in one. He was a monotheist. The only God, our Savior, and he's speaking of the Heavenly Father, the subject here, is also a Savior, the Savior. And Jesus is an appointed Savior functioning as the Father's agent. So then he too becomes a Savior, doesn't he? And we likewise can, as we function for God and bring the gospel to others, function in that role to a limited extent as well. Our only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority. Well, stop. Each of these things is packed with a lot. Glory and majesty and power and authority. Does he have it all? Yeah, but all that is going to be marshaled to you. He's going to use that to make you perfect without fault. Does he have enough glory and majesty and power and authority to do that? Well, he does. He has it in spades, as they say. And then it says, through Jesus our Lord. Yeah, it's going to be done in the same direction that he did it for his son, and to honor his son. Remember, as he began this little one-chapter epistle, short letter, that Jesus was going to keep us in the love of the Father? Well, this is what it says here. In Jesus, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. So it's like this time stamp here, which is goes beyond just the present, this solemn time notation here, which indicates no change in the plan. Divine plans are going to be carried out. How? Well, now and forevermore. Before the ages, now, and forevermore. That pretty well covers it, doesn't it? Before the ages, now, and forevermore. So, nothing's going to stop the divine plan. And as Jude, who ought to know, right at the very center of the heartbeat of the Church of God, the very brother of Jesus, said that what God is doing is perfecting you. And he's going to present you into his glorious presence through the resurrection. And you're going to be with him forever, just like his elder brother Jesus. Forever and ever. That's God's plan. It was before the ages, it is now, and it will be forevermore. And what it involves is your perfect presentation. So do you see perfection in your future? Well, you better, because that is it. He's going to present you perfect, without spot, without blemish, before himself. And he's going to be pleased. And he's going to crown you with crowns and glory and honor and every kind of blessing you could possibly imagine, beyond our imaginations. The God who made the cosmos can do some marvelous things. And he's going to do them for his beloved children, for his sons and daughters. So don't worry about making yourself perfect, thinking that, boy, you got to beat yourself head against the wall, and you got this little fault, or you got that little tick in you, or you got this temptation that you're battling, and you're still battling. Why didn't God take away that temptation? Well, you're still battling it, right? Is that not good? That's all he asks of you. Did not Jesus battle temptations and fight his own will, which might be contrary to the will of God, right down to the end? What did he say? Near the very end of his life, he said, not my will, but yours be done. Which indicated that his will wasn't always the Father's will. Because, you know, he didn't even want to die. So, yes, God is going to see to it that you are presented faultless, perfect. And again, I mentioned the same word is used in 1 Peter 1:9 of the faultless lamb used of Jesus Christ. Can God do that? Well, he did it for his son. He can do it for you, his daughter, and you, his son. And he's going to do it. And this is how Jude ends this letter. He says, hey, we've got an awful lot to look forward to out there. And let's not be distracted by these that come in trying to sell us something cheap. Sell us some plastic Jesus, some plastic Christianity, some phony deal. But let's hold fast to the core of the truth as you've been taught and taught from Scripture. So there is a perfect presentation coming. And it's going to be done by God, and it's going to be done very soon, because when your life ends, the next thing is your presentation before your Heavenly Father, and that'll be done at the resurrection. And for that, we can join Jude in praising to Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you to Himself, to His presence, His glorious presence, without fault and with great joy. We look forward to that moment, don't we? The new magazine, the Sabbath Sentinel, is out. I do recommend this magazine. I have different times here on the web, picture of a Thanksgiving meal here in the current edition. And lead article, again, is one from yours truly, When Image Counts, and other good articles in it besides what I think mine was, a good article, good subject. And we have one from Brian Knowles, Boot Camp for Eternity. I think it was one you'll want to read. And also Ken Ryland's One Man's Remedy for Boring Sermons. You may agree with that one as well. So anyway, write for the magazine. It's free for a while, then you just join the Bible Sabbath Association, $25 a year, and you get it every time it's published, and it's published on a regular basis. And the address is right here in the state of Washington. We're not directly associated with it, but it's the Bible Sabbath Association in Battleground, Washington. And you can go to their website and probably order it through their website, BibleSabbath@comcast.net. BibleSabbath@comcast.net. Or on the web at BibleSabbath.org. BibleSabbath.org. Next week we're going to have two guest speakers. Joanne and I are going to be out of town for the weekend, and we've asked two of our favorite speakers to take over the virtual church, and they'll be doing that. But it'll be phone only, since they'll be doing their contributions from their home offices. Owen Murphy will be speaking to us from British Columbia, up in the high mountain country, and Noel Rood along the coast of Oregon. And they have the subjects here, and I'll give the titles right now, and I'll also post them on our web page. Owen's going to speak on judging righteous judgment. It's going to be tied in Colossians 2:16. Judging righteous judgment. Now, that's a big challenge, isn't it? Judging righteous judgment. We do have to judge, right? And judge righteously. People get all mixed up with this thing. Oh, don't judge, don't judge. You know, they have this idea of tolerance, or this mushy kind of an idea. Well, everything's cool with God, and we just don't judge one another, and people do whatever they want, and we don't judge anybody. Well, that's utter nonsense. That's not what the Scripture says. In fact, the other day I got a call from my son-in-law and granddaughter. They were having a discussion about this thing of judge not, that you be not judged. And it came up in some class or something that our granddaughter had been in. And so they were asking where that passage was. Well, of course, it's in Matthew 7, verse 1. It begins a section. And it's best translated, condemn not, that you be not condemned. And the judgment of a condemnation, kind of a judgment. And it gives forth the principle there, that you're going to be, if that's the way you're going to judge your brother, that's the way God's going to judge you. It's in fairness. You don't forgive your brother, God's don't expect God to forgive you of that same principle. But we have this attitude where people go around, you know, condemning and judging people, looking down their nose at them, picking fault, and you're going to hell, and your skirts are not long enough, or, you know, you drink, and because you drink, you're going to hell or whatever. They have all kind of picky ideas about what a real Christian is, or people have these saying, well, what would Jesus do? It's like, oh, gee, that's automatically understood. And it's like some guy on national TV on the discussion this last week on the minimum wage. They said, well, what would Jesus do about the minimum wage? Oh, he'd be all for it, of course. Oh, he would he? Now, how would you know that? I mean, stupid people. But anyway, the whole business of judging and condemning, you know, we are to judge righteous judgment. And so I'll be interested to hear what Owen has to say there about that passage in Colossians. And also, Noel is going to speak on a subject he is definitely expert on, and that has to do with the book of Genesis, which he's writing a book on the book of Genesis, basically explaining it, particularly the first part and the symbolism involved. And you know, there are two accounts of creation in the book of Genesis that have always caused the problem with people desiring to harmonize the two. And in some ways they harmonize, some ways it doesn't seem like they do. It seems tough and maybe a little confusing, but that's what he's going to talk about. How should we harmonize the two accounts of creation in order to understand what either is about? They're there for a purpose. They each say something. And although the something they say is cast a little differently, what is it that it is saying? So nobody better to talk about it. His title will be Genesis Harmony? And that'll be Noel Rood, a scholar extraordinaire. But that'll be on phone only, so dial up on your phone and just put on speakerphone and listen to it. It'll be good. I was speaking about the Central African Republic, switching here to the world news, and there was a comment in this article here, this AP article by one of the other presidents, one of the countries in Africa, and I think he said quite well. He said, we're appreciative of France, but we know that 50 years after our independence, France is again required to come in as a fireman to save us. And that's what's happening. The French got to come in and save 50 years after their independence. He says, it's not right. This is Alpha Conde, the president of Guinea, G-U-I-N-E-A, small little country. Quote, it's a humiliation for Africa that 50 years afterwards we are not able to manage our problems ourselves, unquote. Well, of course, that's the truth of the matter. Africa is a basket case overall. And now we're celebrating, the people are memorializing, remembering the death of Nelson Mandela. And as far as leaders go, I'm sure he was a good leader. Certainly had some things to recommend him. He didn't come out of jail all bitter and nasty and spit nails and vileness and everything else, but seemed to be respectful of the Constitution, wanting to do things lawfully and so on. But I was alive the whole time before he went in jail and afterwards, and I know the whole story of the African National Congress, of which he was a part and by which he was supported. It was a communist organization. They were there for the overthrow, violent if they had to, of the South African government. People say, oh, well, that was totally totally justified because they were white. Oh, yeah. That's how it goes. Knowing nothing even of the history of South Africa. And even though the government and the apartheid government became ruthless and they needed to clean themselves up and change themselves earlier than being forced into it. But there was a history. Eventually, when they went in and developed South Africa to be a first world nation, the black population was very scant in that part of Africa. It really was. It came there later. Then all of a sudden, it was greater than the white population. Then all of a sudden, the idea was, well, they have to take over. And, of course, that's what's done. And, of course, the nation is, and much of the other nations have gone downhill, like Rhodesia. Now, he set a good example, Nelson Mandela did. He served one term and got out. And other leaders there said, well, they're going to follow this as a good example. They got in by elections, but once they got in and got the power and the trappings and everything, they didn't want out. So they forced their little legislatures and the rest to change the rules so that they could stay on for another term and another term and another term. And there's Mugabe and some of the others there, and Zimbabwe and some of these nations have stayed on for decade after decade. Run the nation into the ground. Rhodesia was a prosperous breadbasket, a first world nation for all of Africa. Now it's, again, one of these starving basket cases. What did he do? He declared war on the whites, stole their farms from them, stole the industry from them, destroyed the economic base and ruined them, chased them out. Talk about racism. What's he left with? A miserable country that has to import food and beg from others. And then one despot after another, you can go through the whole country and you see the same pattern. People like to think, wonderful things happened down there. Mandela just changed everything. Well, where's the evidence of it? There's really no evidence. I wonder if people really understand what a great man is and what is the legacy that has really changed something. I don't see that legacy at all. And meanwhile, the political parade is all going to go down there because they want to hang on the goat tails. It's like Martin Luther King became terribly popular after his death. Everybody and his brother knew him as his best friend, you know, so they could sort of roll along on the coattails of a civil rights leader, and somehow that gave him some sort of credulence. It's all political shammery is what it is. Well, we'll be dealing with the problems there. I mean, Africa is a mess. And, of course, what's making it worse now is the Muslims and their war against Christians. And we don't hear too much about that over here because, you know, we want to be politically correct. Plus, black killing black, but in this case, Muslim black killing black, Christian blacks. Doesn't seem to bother people too much. Should bother them terribly. But it doesn't. It shows the utter hypocrisy of the American so-called civil rights bunch, which in many cases are nothing more than a bunch of race hucksters themselves. Well, turn with me to the book of Colossians. And the first chapter of the book of Colossians, I've titled this, How Would Paul Pray for You? Well, we've got a good idea here. And maybe if we see how he would pray for you, you might get an idea how you ought to pray for one another. And I think get a good insight into priorities. And this is Paul writing to the Colossians, and we're just going to read a few of the first verses here in the first chapter, but it'll give you a sense of how he saw people and what he saw the needs of people, that be us, you know, church people, Christian people, scattered Christian people. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. So he saw that his calling was by the will of God, and he was an apostle, that is, a witness of Jesus Christ, like the 12 apostles. And Timothy, our brother, includes him because he was co-pastoring here, ministering with Paul on his trips. To the holy and faithful brothers in Christ in Colossae, big town, important town in Asia Minor. But I like the way he talks to people. Holy and faithful brothers, and that means brothers, sisters, you know, brethren, in Colossae. And can we call one another holy? Well, we don't use that terminology too much today, but the sense of it is of a very respectful way. I mean, we think of human life as sacrosanct and being holy, no matter whether you're pagan or Christian or a little tiny baby in a womb or whatever, it's sacrosanct. But here he's talking about Christians, and all the more so that they're holy. Why would they be holy? Well, because a holy God called them. Knows what he said? He's an apostle by the will of God. So you better watch what you say to Paul. I mean, if you're going to criticize him, because God called him, right? And he has a holy calling. So he's a holy apostle, if we use that term. And it's not like he's trying to exalt himself. No, he doesn't even use it for himself. He's using it to address the people. They're holy people because they've been called of God. They have God's spirit, God's blessing, God's eye. Makes them holy. Would that change your attitude toward people at all if you saw them in a little bit more of that light? Or do we see them as fallible human beings always? Having a profile and a pedigree of faults and laundry list of sins and history and all that. And holy is not a word we'd use anywhere near them. So maybe we ought to rethink that and see how God might see your fellow Christian. Paul didn't have any problem calling them holy, did he? It wasn't that he was unaware that they might have human problems. And he says, grace and peace to you from God our Father. So he always leads from the top. He knows he's there at the will of God the Father, called by God the Father, and he represents the God of the universe, the God of all creation. And he's an apostle of Jesus. So there, that's where he stands. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. Now, why can't modern Christians have the order of things as clear and as natural and just flow out like Paul does? Why do they all have to be so confused? I get some of these nice things, like this is our daily bread here, put out by a Christian organization, do fine work, you know, nice people. And I read Christianity Today, and I read the articles in it, and, you know, they're nice people that try to do good things, and this is put out by RCM Ministry Radio Bible Church or Baptist Church. I don't know what it is, but anyway, so often in their writings, they talk about Jesus as God, or they kind of mix them together like they're both God. It's hard to even know who they're talking about. Doesn't seem like they know. Because in their mind, there are two gods there. There's Jesus God, there's God God. And so it's rather confusing. Paul doesn't doesn't operate with such confusion. Seems to have a better idea, doesn't he? Do you think that's important? Well, I think so. If you're going to be an apostle of Jesus Christ, you ought to know who God is, who Jesus is, and who you are. Well, we always thank God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ when we pray for you, because we have heard that of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all the saints, the faith and love that spring from the hope that is stored up for you in heaven that you have already heard about in the Word of Truth. So they had received the gospel, the good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They believed it. They were following it. That is the good news of the kingdom, that we can live forever, and that there's going to be a reward stored up for you in heaven, and that you've heard this from the Word of Truth. Now, what's the Word of Truth? Well, he's not referring to the book of Colossians as the Bible here, because it wasn't even considered Bible or Scripture for the most part at the time of the writing here. It later was. The Word of Truth, comma, the gospel that has come to you. The gospel, the good news. The kingdom of God is the Word of Truth. All over the world, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and understood God's grace in all its truth. A little hyperbole here, of course, you know, all, it's been, you know, growing all over the world. Well, maybe not in Siberia, and maybe not North America, maybe, you know, but that isn't what his reference is here. To the immediate world, it's been spreading to various parts, is the expression that he's using here. Not to be taken slavishly, literally. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ our Lord on our behalf, and who also told you of told us of your love in the Spirit. What do you mean, love in the Spirit? Well, it means real love, spiritual love, love as Christians, not feigned love, or not love because they were getting something, or love because they liked our personality, but love in the Spirit of true Christianity, of truth. In other words, they were kindred spirits, fellow believers. And that's what they communicated back to Paul, that these people are like us. They have God's Spirit, and they have God's love. And that's why Paul addresses them as, you know, holy and faithful. So, and he commends this faithful minister, because it all doesn't come through one channel. How did you first learn the truth, as it says here, the Word of Truth, the gospel? Well, you might have heard of bits and pieces here, there, from someone here, maybe some guy on the radio once, maybe in a book somewhere else, maybe from a grandmother, maybe from a mother, maybe going to Sunday school or Sabbath school or somewhere. Could be various ways, maybe a preacher, maybe none of the above, some other way. That you learned various ways in which people encounter God, or God encounters them. Let's put it that way. As Jesus said there in the book of John, nobody comes into to the Son except the Father first draw him. So the initiator is always God the Father. And Jesus tells us that. Always God the Father. And so that's where we need to realize our salvation comes. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. In other words, we put you on our prayer list as soon as we found out you were there, and we've continued to be thinking and praying about you. That's reassuring, isn't it? It's nice to know that somebody's thinking about you and praying about you. One of the worst feelings in the world is just the feeling of being alone, you know, where nobody cares. Well, you know, God always cares, but or you should know. But if we can know that out there are people that know us by name, think about us, are concerned about our welfare, our well-being, our happiness, are concerned when they hear of troubles or trials, genuinely so. That we know we're not alone, that people do love us and are praying for us. Now, we won't always hear those prayers, will we? Because they're given to God, not to us. Occasionally somebody might mention, you know, I've been praying for you, or, yeah, I remember to pray for you, or so on. Or you might say to somebody sometime, well, don't forget to pray for me, and they'll come back and they say, well, I regularly do. Well, that's nice to hear. So Paul said, we've not stopped praying for you. So how'd you like Paul praying for you? Well, he prayed to the same God that Epaphras prayed to, or any of us would pray to. So you say, well, yeah, but Paul, he has got a special channel to God. Well, he certainly was a strong follower of God, and God heard his prayers. So that'd be wonderful, that Paul praying for you. And if Paul were praying for you, how would he pray for you? Well, in the next couple of verses, we get an idea of exactly how he might pray for you. Never stop praying for you, asking God to fill you with the knowledge of his will. Oh, knowledge of his, that is God's will. That takes knowledge. Now, how do you find it? Well, you have to do some searching, don't you? You need to be filled up. It's not there automatically. You're not born with it. You have to be filled with it. You have to learn it. And that is comes through study. It comes through teaching, maybe, of people like Epaphras and Paul, and expository learning and studying the scriptures, studying Torah, studying Proverbs, where you get wisdom and so on. That's where it comes from. The knowledge of his will. Now, to be filled with it. Now, how full do you want to be? Now, some people want to always drive the car with a full tank. Why? Because it feels a lot more secure. They just don't like the idea of running out of gas somewhere. Well, I understand that. But when it comes to knowledge of God, do we have the attitude, well, I want to get all the possible knowledge of God I can, and of the God's will, and just be filled with it? Or are we kind of casual, thinking, oh, well, I'm not so sure what his will is, and, well, I go to church once in a while, so like that takes care of it? That's not what Paul's talking about. That's not the focus of his prayer for you. Fill you with the knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Well, now it gets layered here with some more depth, doesn't it? Spiritual wisdom. And again, I reference Proverbs. That's a source of a lot of spiritual wisdom. And Psalms. And understanding. Now that comes from knowledge, wisdom, and then understanding how to apply it. So there's quite a bit here, isn't it? And this is what he taught them. This is what Paul busied himself teaching them, was the knowledge of God, spiritual wisdom, and understanding. And why did he do that? Well, just so they could be really smart and pass the test. My wife's a good test taker. She likes taking tests. She's good at it. And she's taking some new tests right now for some added certification, long tests and so on. And you got to get all the questions pretty well right, or at least a high percentage of them, in order to pass the test. And it's important because you got to pay for these tests. You got to spend hundreds of hours sometimes study and background material and experience going into it. So it's pretty important, and it takes time and effort to get to that point. But there's a purpose for it, and it's something you're going to use. Well, what is the purpose here? Well, Paul tells you in the next verse, and we pray this, you know, this deep prayer here. In order that, so we're getting to the purpose here of what this wisdom, understanding, and God's will and knowledge of God and so on would do. In order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please Him in every way. Now that's the outcome of it. That's the reason behind it. In other words, that you may live a godly life, that you may take on the very divine nature. What was it that the Father said on the two occasions when we actually hear Him give His opinion publicly of a Son? Well, that He loved Him and that He was well pleased with Him. Because of what? Well, because the Son was doing all that He could with His effort. And His intent and His work and all these things Paul's talking about here, praying for, to live a life worthy of His Heavenly Father, to please Him in every way. He said, I do all things to please Him. That's a quote from Jesus. I do all things to please Him. So the purpose of this prayer, Paul, was just that we would be like Jesus, that we would move Godward in our daily life, that we would live a life worthy. Is that a moral life? Yes. It is a loving life? Yes. A worthwhile one? Yes. Joyful? Yes. All the qualities of goodness and God's Spirit in this life. And may please Him in every way. You know, not just in one way, but in every way. Not just that you've got a lot of knowledge or you're a good Bible quoter or you go to church every week and you strut around like you're, you know, Mrs. Christian Lady. But in every way, how you treat people, your humility, your hospitality, your generosity, all these are the things that come forth from this spiritual wisdom and understanding and knowledge of His will. There's so much packed into this, and this is what Paul's praying about. He's praying with an object in mind, that there's a reason for this, that we may live a certain kind of a life, a good life, a godly life, bearing fruit in every good work. So it produces good work toward God, what He's wanting us to do, good work toward others, in helping and serving others all around. It's like we were discussing the other week of even Josephus' remarks about Jesus went about doing good. That was His legacy. People remembered Him as such. Every good work growing in the knowledge of God. Growing. Now, this is not an instantaneous thing, by the way. It's kind of like these big old sequoia trees or these pine cone trees up in the Sierras or redwoods. You know, grows and grows. It gets taller and taller, and it takes years and years to develop a full understanding of the knowledge of God, and then it never... quite full then until we meet Him face to face, but it's a growing into the knowledge of God. Now Jesus did that. He said, look, you've seen Me, you've seen Him. That is, we're the same in spirit and attitude and love and temperament and judgment. So can we achieve that on this earth? Well, yes. That's what it's all about. Growing in the knowledge of God. Well, in order to do that, you have to know what God is like. And people wonder why I do these seminars, you know, around the country on the knowledge of God, the nature of God, the nature of Jesus. It's for this very purpose, that people can grow in the knowledge of God, really come to know who He is, the one true God, the Creator, the lover of mankind, and His Son, who's taken on His image and is going to lead us into his everlasting kingdom, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that we might have great endurance and patience. Now, these are some of the outworking things that Paul was also praying for, that when we're living this kind of life and God's strengthening us, you know, we're going to have endurance, we're going to have patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. Now, who's qualified you? The Father has. And what are you going to do? Well, you're going to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. Another way to say the kingdom of God, the kingdom of truth, the kingdom of peace, the everlasting kingdom, His Majesty's kingdom. So, and He's qualified you for that. It's like Jude was saying, He's going to present you perfect. Now, can He do that? Yes, He can. And what was Paul's prayer here? Well, for this very purpose. So, would you want Paul to pray for you? Well, this is what he'd be praying. Just like this. And this is what he would want, you know, that you would have this knowledge of God's will, being filled, wisdom, understanding, living a life worthy, pleasing God in every way, growing in the knowledge of God. And out from that would come endurance and patience and a joyfulness as you look forward to the future, giving thanks to God who's qualified you for this kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness. Now, He includes Himself with this. Us. The dominion of darkness that we used to live in ignorance, our sins, our blindness, and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves. Yeah, this is the one who's going to be heading up the Father's glorious kingdom on earth, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sin. Yeah, that's why we're qualified by the Father to be in this kingdom of light. That's a nice prayer. Now, when you're praying for some other Christians, I want you to think about how Paul prays for Christians. And these are Christians that some of them he didn't even know the names of. He knew about them. He knew about them through this other minister who told him about them. But that was enough for him to pray and write. And he prayed for them, but I really appreciate the specificity with which he laid out the things he prayed about and the purpose for his prayers. There was an outcome. There was a reason for the things he asked for. And the reason was that they would live this life worthy. In other words, a life taking on the image of God. And that's going to cause them to share in the kingdom of light and the inheritance of the saints forever. So it's pretty good business. Pretty beautiful story, isn't it? Pretty wonderful prayer. And it's a prayer that you could use as a model as you pray for others. And know that this is exactly what God wants out of you as well. Well, we're going to close with a couple of old favorite songs here. The Lord is my shepherd, and trust and obey. But before we do that, we'll ask God's dismissal. And again, a reminder, we will have guest speakers next week. Owen Murphy, Noel Rood, on phone service only. So check with our website for the titles and then just dial up. It's very easy and virtually cost-free. Little cost, not much anymore with the phone. It's pretty cheap. Join me as we pray. Our Father in heaven, we ask that you would watch over your people. Shower us with your love. Let your face shine upon us. Help those that are in very cold areas to find enough warmth to stay warm feed those that need to be fed, Father. Protect your Christians who are being persecuted. Give them endurance and give them strength. And help us, Father, to fulfill the prayer that your great servant Paul prayed for the fellow saints, his fellow brothers and sisters in Colossae, that they would be filled with the knowledge of you and of your will and of the spiritual understanding that you give us and you have for us. Bless us now as we go our way. Help us to live a life worthy of you this year, to please you as we move into a brand new year, 2014. And help us to let our light shine to others, that they may see our good works and so give glory to you. We ask your blessing and dismissal now. In this we pray in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. Okay, let's listen to "The Lord is My Shepherd." And truly He is.
The Lord's my shepherd, I not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green.
Thank you.
Or we'll walk.